This is Joe Minardi from West Virginia University, and this is our e-poster for the American Institute of Ultrasound and Medicine Scientific Assembly 2020. The title is A POCUS First Strategy and Acute Diverticulitis. Just want to take a quick second to thank our co-authors, Dr. End, Dr. Davis, Dr. Whiteman, Ms. Sharon, Dr. Dorenzi, and Dr. Pagenhart. So as a brief intro, we all know if we work in emergency medicine or in radiology that diverticulitis is a very common disease process. We admit lots of people to the hospital for it. We spend a lot of money on this, and we frequently perform CT scans to make a diagnosis. What we hope to demonstrate is that in some scenarios, point of care ultrasound may provide adequate diagnostic information. We're going to go through four cases where ultrasound first strategy, selective CT strategy, was successfully employed. We're going to review the findings that include one or more diverticuli, some of the pericolic inflammatory changes, the echogenic mesenteric fat, thickened bowel wall, and then findings of complicated disease such as abscess. So our first case is a 46-year-old previously healthy woman with left abdominal and flank pain with a negative urine. Point of care ultrasound was performed that showed a diverticulum containing a fecal lith and thickened bowel surrounded by echogenic fat in the left lower quadrant. And this was over the patient's exact location of pain. We'll show you the images of that. There was no free fluid, no other complicating findings. The rest of the point of care ultrasound, which included kidneys and bladder and things, was normal. There weren't any other high-risk clinical features. The white blood cell count was normal. So this patient was managed as an outpatient with antibiotics and did well. The next case is of a 70-year-old female who had left-sided abdominal pain as well. Patient was afebrile with left-sided abdominal tenderness, but no peritoneal signs and a normal urine. The point of care ultrasound showed prominent bowel in the left colon and a visible diverticulum, all surrounded by echogenic inflammatory fat. The diverticulum appeared as a dark pouch that communicated with the bowel lumen. There was no free fluid and the white blood cell count was normal. This patient had no high-risk features and was also managed medically and did well at follow-up. So here is the first figure from the first case where we see this is the large intestine. We see here a little diverticulum with an echogenic fecal lith and an acoustic shadow, and we see bright white echogenic inflammatory fat surrounding this area of intestine, and this also was very tender to sonopalpation. Our second figure in the second case shows the bowel lumen with a pretty clear diverticulum and lots of bright echogenic fat, which gives this kind of a sausage appearance of the bowel inside this area of echogenic fat, but no other fluid collections or loss of bowel wall integrity is noted. In our third case, we have a 56-year-old woman who'd had a prior history of colonic perforation from diverticulitis. This patient had only had a brief bout of midline lower abdominal pain that was similar to prior episodes. Patient was afebrile with lower abdominal tenderness and no peritoneal signs. Point of care ultrasound showed left abdominal and suprapubic intestinal thickening with a positive pseudokidney sign and no other fluid collections, so no ultrasound findings of complicated disease. However, the white blood cell count was remarkably high, 21.5. Due to this, in conjunction with her history of significant complications in the past, CT was performed where the ultrasound findings were confirmed. She was admitted for just medical management and did well. In our last case, we have a 41-year-old female who had recently been diagnosed with diverticulitis on an outpatient basis based on clinical findings. The patient was having continued symptoms despite a few days of antibiotics. The point of care ultrasound showed dilated bowel loops in the lower abdomen and an adjacent fluid collection that was consistent with abscess. So this was a high risk imaging finding with point of care ultrasound. So due to this, CT was performed, findings were confirmed, the patient was treated with percutaneous drain, IV antibiotics, and she recovered and did well afterwards. So here are findings from these cases. So from case three, we see a pseudo kidney sign here. So this is a bowel loop kind of wrapping around the mesentery, and there's a little inflammatory fat out here. So this is a non-specific inflammatory finding, not specific to diverticulitis. And in this case, several bowel loops were seen and then this fluid collection was seen, which suggested an abscess, and that was confirmed by CT as well. So just to discuss this briefly, we all know abdominal pain is very common complaint in the emergency department. And retrospective studies have shown we've dramatically increased advanced imaging and CT scan in emergency department patients with abdominal pain, but we really haven't seen concomitant improvement in diagnosis or outcomes for these patients. There have been a lot of studies, and we'll reference these, that have proposed ultrasound as the initial diagnostic tool in patients like this. And it's our opinion, with the high prevalence of diverticulitis, employing a more selective CT strategy should help decrease the exposure to ionizing radiation and help us with our resource utilization in the emergency department. So we propose an ultrasound first strategy, and we think this is worth further investigation, where we reserve CT for higher risk clinical or sonographic features. So hopefully those four cases were interesting, and we demonstrated how we employed it in these series of cases, and we followed this algorithm, which we think is worthy of further study and possible validation with prospective studies. So the algorithm goes like this: suspected diverticulitis, history physical, risk assessment. And if the patient has high clinical risk of complicated disease, then you could probably go straight to CT scan. If they don't really have high clinical risk of complicated disease, you can do the ultrasound. And then if you find findings of complicated disease, then you could move to CT scan. If the ultrasound is negative or looks like uncomplicated findings on ultrasound, then you could treat them and counsel them. And probably the most important thing is explicit instructions on follow-up and reasons to return. Here are some of our references. The available Twitter handles for our authors are here, so hit us up on Twitter or email us if you have any questions or thoughts. And thank you for your time and attention.